Good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining me for the presentation on SolGold and our status with our projects in Ecuador. My name is Nick Mather. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of SolGold, which is an emerging copper gold major on a global stage. We have a major project in Ecuador where we have the Alpala project, one of the world's most important emerging copper gold development stories. In fact, we believe it is the most financeable, largest copper gold project that's available for development funding in the world. This places SolGold on the cusp of becoming one of the world's copper gold majors, and this is backed up by a fantastic pipeline of copper gold porphyry projects through a very unexplored sector of the Andean copper belt in Ecuador. So I'm going to tell you about the emergence of the company, and in particular about the emergence of Alpala as our guiding and leading project. Firstly, I want you to read this cautionary notice in great detail, and as is customary for me, I'll take questions on that at the end and see how you go with the cautionary notice. But first of all, coronavirus, how does that affect us in Ecuador, and how is it affecting Ecuador? It's obviously something which affects all exploration and development operations around the world. And first of all, I want to point out that we're very committed to the safety and well-being of our employees, and very compliant with the state's policy of making sure that we protect our communities rather that we work within in Ecuador. So we're working largely from home and continue to progress our projects using available databases on all of our exploration and the Alpala feasibility and eventual development project in Ecuador. We are, as a result of the government's efforts to gradually release activities back in Ecuador, back on the ground in our project areas, and our community liaison efforts have rewarded us with permission for measured access to the areas where we really need to get into to get our projects going. Unlike the approach of a lot of companies, we have not laid anybody off or fired anybody. We've continued to keep all of our employees in full gainful employment. And this has been very good for our regard in the Ecuadorian community at all levels, from individual employees to their families, local communities, local and provincial governments, and indeed the national government. So Ecuador, as with all of our endeavours in the country, can see that we're working to look after Ecuador as much as our people, our project, and our shareholders. We do this by continuing to monitor the health and well-being of our workforce, and actively supporting our local communities as we work through this this difficult time. The main reason for our claim that we're an emerging copper gold major is twofold. We've discovered the Alpala resource, which has just on 10 million tons of copper and nearly 22 million ounces of gold and over 90 million ounces of silver in the last mineral resource estimate, which produces on our metallurgical studies a very high quality, clean, high value concentrate. And this has led to a very spiky front end cash flow, which enables us to deliver some financial economic metrics, which are the envy of the exploration and mine development world globally. We're looking at a 55-year mine life with a net present value of a medium value of around $4.4 billion US and an enviable internal rate of return of nearly 26%. And this project, because it is geologically characteristic of the rest of Ecuador, provides us with the basis to reasonably predict that each one of our 13 other projects that we've pegged through the country has the opportunity to deliver equally important tier one projects as we build the asset base of SolGold and make SolGold one of the world's most important copper producing companies, and certainly the mainstay ultimately of the emergent mining industry in Ecuador. We have backing up that the largest land position in Ecuador. We've drilled more meters than anybody else, nearly 230 kilometers of drilling. We've got 76 exploration concessions, all of which, with the exception of Alpala, are 100% owned and cover over 3,000 square kilometres of surface area. The blueprint that we've developed at Alpala in exploration techniques, technological applications, regulatory approach, and the engagement with the community is one which will see the rapid and efficient application of our efforts in exploration programs all through these other areas through Ecuador, and it will mean that we will be able to speedily and cost efficiently set about the task of identifying other projects which will back up a pipeline of we believe readily financeable ultimately tier one copper gold resource projects to develop and thus build a company which is important to Ecuador as BHP was to Australia, as that great company became one of the main resource stays of the Australian economy. We aim to do the same thing in Ecuador. We have just a $545 million US market capitalization, and we're trading at a very low multiple of our project value. This, of course, places us in a reasonably vulnerable position from the point of view of an opportunistic takeover. And accordingly, we have appointed the City Group as our advisors to make sure that we can withstand the ravages of early opportunistic takeover bids. Not only did we discover and define Alpala to date for just $1.97 per ounce equivalent of the resource, but we believe the same sort of metrics will apply to our other exploration targets through these other projects, other 13 targets in Ecuador, and that indeed makes SolGold one of the greatest investment opportunities that we believe that the exploration and mining sector has seen for quite some considerable time. Our company has just over 2 billion shares on issue, 2 billion and 72 million, and trading at recent share prices, a market capitalization of £440 million, or just $545 million. And you need to note that that's against a median net present value out of the preliminary economic analysis of $4.4 billion for the project. As a result of our recent equity raising, we have approximately $50 million in the bank. And assuming that Franco-Nevada gets through the final due diligence process involving a site visit in a COVID environment in Ecuador, we should have another $100 to $150 million, depending on what we draw down from that royalty agreement. And that money will see us through all of the pre-feasibility, feasibility studies, the supporting financing activities, general activities and administrative costs, and the regional exploration costs to see us through both the initial stages of exploration on those other areas, and also to get to a development decision stage on the Alpala project. We have BHP as our largest shareholder. That certainly endorses BHP's view of the quality of the project. Newcrest is the second largest shareholder, and that's certainly coming from Australia's largest gold producer, endorses their view of the quality of the gold mineralisation in this project. The company I'm executive director of, listed on ASX, DGR Global, is the third largest shareholder, and I personally hold, through my company, Samuel Holdings, over 4% of the company. So I'm strongly invested. In fact, all of our management team and board are significantly invested in this company. We all have our hearts and minds in the same line and on the same track as shareholders. We are reviewed and researched by Hanman Partners, JP Morgan, Liberum, Peel Hunt, Cormark, Red Cloud and Cantor. And there are many more analysts around the world that all have similar views of the target price that this company should be achieving. Certainly Newcrest and BHP's position in the company and the latest agreement with Franco-Nevada, who's one of the world's great gold mine development funding companies, would endorse the safety of Ecuador as an exploration and mining destination, the quality of the project, and in the case of Franco-Nevada, the qualities of the management team. So we're fully funded, assuming we get through the Franco-Nevada final stages of due diligence. We're endorsed by some of the world's great companies. We're seeing that Ecuador is increasingly a desirable place for destination for mining investment and development capital. And we can replicate this many times over on our 13 other targets that are wholly owned in four different subsidiaries down through the whole 700-kilometre extent of this very exciting part of the Andean Copper Belt in Ecuador. Our board is chaired by Brian Moller, who also has a significant investment in the company. Rob Weinberg has been an independent director for some years now and has a lot of experience and former director of the World Gold Council. Legal representation in Canada from James Clare, and Craig Jones from Newcrest is on our board as well. And the most recent board appointee, Liam Twigger, is a mining finance consultant based in Perth in Western Australia and has had considerable experience financing these sorts of projects. Importantly, the management team is headed up by Jason Ward, who's in charge of the project in Ecuador. And underneath him, we garner the services of Dr. Steve Garwin, who's a globally acclaimed porphyry expert. The head of the feasibility studies is Eduardo Valenzuela, very experienced with large porphyry projects in Chile. And Ben Whistler has been with us for a very long time and in charge of the collection and maintenance and organisation of the very impressive database over nearly 230 kilometres of drilling, all diamond core drilling. We've got quarter or half cores of every single metre that we've drilled through. Santiago Vaca has been in charge of the collection of all of that data. And importantly, Santiago is an example of our approach to employment in Ecuador. We prefer to employ Ecuadorians. 97% of our workforce is Ecuadorian, and that helps to get the endorsement of the Ecuadorian people and the Ecuadorian nation when it comes to the ultimate development of this project. Recently, of course, our efforts have been focusing on financing, and Inga Hoffmeyer, ex-Hanneman Partners and ex-Rio, is in charge of the financing efforts. He's done a fantastic job over the first year that he's been with us, and has been instrumental in putting in place the deal with Franco-Nevada and the recent $40 million equity raising. So we're building on all of our skills, technically, financially, legally, and from a fiscal negotiation point of view with the Ecuadorian government. So I want to tell you a little bit about Ecuador. We are the largest concession holder in Ecuador. For a junior company, title is vital, and we've made sure that we have plenty of it. So we've applied for our tenures on the basis of similar geological characteristics throughout the length of Ecuador, and that's been based on what we discovered at Alpala, starting off with the first drill holes in late 2013 and early 2014. We have a recipe, we have a blueprint, and we're applying it regularly all over the country. As you can see from the photograph here, we're equal opportunity employers. We very much value the very detailed skills and observance of the female geologists that we have on our team, and we're finding that they're tremendously useful in detailed observations all through all of our exploration projects. And my thanks go to the ladies of SolGold, and particularly the Ecuadorian ladies that are helping to gain endorsement and enriching the database of this very exciting project. As I mentioned before, we're exploring the length of Ecuador, and there's three parallel metallogenic belts there that you can see on the left-hand side of this slide. And if you superimpose that geology and that geography over Chile, you cover northern Chile, and it covers some 25% of the world's copper resources and copper production. That gives you some idea of the fantastic prospectivity that we enjoy through Ecuador, and it gives you some idea of the importance of the first mover advantage that we secured in 2014, as we identified 13 other sites throughout the length of Ecuador on which to potentially discover some more of these tier one copper gold porphyry systems. So very exciting time for SolGold, and something that has set the company up for the next 10 to 30 years, as we said, about identifying a pipeline of porphyry copper projects that give us control of an entire sector of the world's most important copper belt, the Andean copper belt. And there are no other companies in the world that have secured a dominant position in an entire prospective belt as SolGold has. We believe that ultimately this will lead to the discovery of some super monsters like Escondida, Chuquicamata, these sorts of projects evident in northern Chile. And ultimately the same sort of thing we believe will emerge in Ecuador, and SolGold has set ourselves up to be at the forefront of that exploration endeavour. Now, one might reasonably ask, why have we not found, or why has nobody ever found these sorts of projects in Ecuador before? And the reason is basically the weather. In Chile, as you can see in this photograph of one of the high walls at Escondida, the ground is very barren. You can see these deposits from space with satellite photography, and that has led to the emergence of a strong mining industry in Chile. In Ecuador, however, you have, because you're closer to the equator, you have cloud, you have rain, you have soil development, you have vegetation, and all of these things have masked observations of mineralized porphyry copper gold system. So while Ecuador was looking for and developing oil in the Western Amazon Basin and becoming a member of OPEC, and people looking for porphyries in Chile, where you could see them in the Southwest Pacific, where they developed sophisticated airborne magnetic surveys. Nothing was really going on in Ecuador. And it was the emergence of those sophisticated magnetic detection systems, airborne magnetics, that when applied to similar terrains as you have in the Southwest Pacific to Ecuador, enabled us to see through the cloud, the rain, the soil and vegetation cover, and identify these magnetite rich or magnetic signified porphyry systems. So we're very interested in the complex cluster of magnetic signatures in the southern part of our tenure here around Alpala. And it was this magnetic feature down around Alpala, very complex, and the occurrence of an outcrop of the Alpala porphyry system in Alpala Creek that led us to the first drill holes there. We refined our targeting with geochemistry. If magnetics tells you where the smoke is, the geochemistry tells you where the fire is. We identified manganese lows, which tells you where the systems have been hot and wet and mineralized. They're fertile when you find high molybdenum values, and you know that they're pregnant with copper when you have a high copper to zinc ratio. And that's why, along with the complexity of the system, that we went to Alpala on the southern part of the tenement. But of course, we've also found mineralization at Aguanaga, which promises to yield a resource, and also at Tandayama, America, where we have strong geochemical and magnetic signatures, but we've not yet done any drilling. So there's plenty of upside on the Cascabel tenement, and we've only really touched the surface of it at Alpala, where we already have defined a global tier one discovery. So I'll tell you a little bit about Alpala. It's the first of our pipeline, but obviously a very, very important one, as it lays the economic foundations for the development of SolGold as one of the world's great copper companies. Now, all of this would be wonderful if we found it high and dry in the Chilean Andes, but we don't have that. We have a project that is richer in gold, has a high-grade copper core. We don't have to build a highway, a power line, a water pipeline, a desalination plant, and a power plant. It's all laid on for us. It's already there. And this presents us with some opportunities for tremendous capital expenditure savings as we go into the development decision phase for the Alpala project after we finalise the feasibility study. So the advantages that came from Ecuador having the presence of mind to invest the money that they made from oil revenues into infrastructure in the country places us in a very competitive position when it comes to attracting global mine financing capital. We can drive to it. We've got a dedicated workforce nearby. We've got an international hydroelectric power network that passes about 30 kilometres to the southeast of the project. We have available water. We've got two Pacific ports down on the Pacific coast. The one at Esmeraldas has a deep water facility already. The logistics are fantastic here. We've got a sealed highway which passes through the northeastern corner of the tenement. There are very few projects around the world of this magnitude that have such fantastic logistics support. We own 85% of this project legally and beneficially through Exploraciones Nova Mining SA, or ENSA. Our junior shareholder in the company will have to contribute at least 10% to the development stage, which we hope to be making a decision on as early as end of June next year, or dilute to a 0.5% net smelter return, which SolGold may then acquire for $3.5 million. I do point out that SolGold is in the process of bidding for Cornerstone to acquire that interest and consolidate the project interest. Our alternatives to success in that bid are not dissuasive either. So we own 85% of it. We've spent over $200 million US to date on the project, and we're fully funded to get to the development decision, provided we get through the Franco-Nevada final stages of due diligence. And the junior partner also has to refund its 15% share of our costs since we earned our interest from 90% of their share of proceeds from the tenement. So we're in a good position from an ownership point of view. When we first drilled into this project in 2014, we found intersections that placed us in the same house as some of the world's major copper gold porphyry projects, and our drilling intersections, which exceed 1.3 kilometres in length, certainly endorse that claim. Our mineral resource estimate of nearly 22 million ounces of gold and nearly 10 million tonnes of copper, certainly, and the high-grade core of it makes us a tier one project. And we have some 2.4 billion tonnes of resource inventory at a 0.54% copper equivalent run of mine grade. That is going to result in some spectacular production rates of over 200,000 tonnes of copper a year for the first 25 years, over 400,000 ounces of gold, and over a million ounces of silver a year for the first 25 years. So the metallurgical characteristics are showing that we get a very high grade concentrate, low in deleterious elements, and some very good enviable copper and gold recoveries. We are working on improvements to those at the moment, and we fully expect to get some decent improvements to the metallurgical recoveries when we get through the pre-feasibility and feasibility study stages, and that's indicated here on this slide as well. You can see the very important improvements in gold recovery that we've got through refinements in the flotation circuit and extraction of gold from the pyrite concentrate. From the Franco-Nevada deal point of view, we have $100 million, which comes for a 1% royalty, subject to finalising the due diligence with a site visit. We can amp that up to $150 million by going to 1.5% royalty. Importantly, we can buy back 50% of that at a 12% internal rate of return, which puts to rest at least half of the objections that some of the major companies have to us having done this deal. But we did this deal because it's way less dilutive to shareholders. It's based off a $3 billion NPV rather than a $550 million market capitalization. So it's a fantastic deal from a value point of view, and one that we certainly looked forward to developing a good ongoing relationship with Franco-Nevada. We do have the opportunity, we believe, to also crystallise a $1 billion upfront financing deal based on a gold stream with a streaming company. And we're working on that, plus debt deals with sovereign import and export credit agencies. And that will hopefully provide somewhere in excess of $2 billion of the $2.7 billion that we need to develop this project. I'm not going to go into the details of Franco-Nevada. However, do have a look at this slide. You will see that the Franco-Nevada of the upside in the gold price certainly endorses the quality and the eventual fiscal outcomes from the Alpala project. And it helps to tell you why the Franco-Nevada deal is a way, way better way of going about raising the $150 million that will see us through to development funding. We are the most financeable copper gold project from a porphyry point of view in the world at the moment. Yes, there are bigger projects in the DRC and at Pebble. However, the grades are low or the jurisdictions are horrible, and Alpala stands out like a gem in comparison to everything else available. We have both pre-feasibility and feasibility work streams well underway. We're on track to deliver the pre-feasibility study by end Q3, early Q4 in 2020. And we're working towards completion of the definitive feasibility study at the end of Q3 in 2021. So we're running all of the permitting, the feasibility studies, the financing negotiations, and the fiscal framework negotiations with the Ecuadorian government in parallel to all try and coincide to be able to make a development decision in the second half of 2021 and try and get into production first up in sometime in 2025. The reason this project is so financeable is because of the very spiky high-end cash flow. It gives us a four-year payback on a 55-year mine life and underwrites the 26% internal rate of return and a median NPV of $4.4 billion on $2.7 billion worth of CapEx. We're looking continually for improvements in both OpEx and CapEx to make this even more spectacular. And every one of these style of projects that we can define through the Ecuadorian chain will make the growth profile of SolGold as a corporation even more spectacular. That's why the Ecuadorian government likes us, and that's why we're going to be able to ultimately deliver one of the world's great copper gold companies. We sit in the lowest copper cost production quartile. Again, it makes us fantastically financeable. For the first 25 years, our cost of production is about 25 cents per pound just for the copper, and the gold would come for nothing. A regional program, I'll touch on this very briefly. I've mentioned before that we hold 13 projects across 75 licenses granted. There's more applications which we believe are close to grant. We hold these in four wholly owned subsidiaries. They cover the length of Ecuador. They have the same spatial frequency as the major projects that you see in northern Chile, which is almost identical from a geological point of view. So we've got a geological model in northern Chile. We've got a blueprint for the exploration and appraisal of one of these systems that we developed at Alpala. And we have three projects that we're preparing for drilling activities on. And we have two or three more that are a very high priority that we're working on getting the permits for. So already at a very early stage, we have five or six projects which stand out and look even better at surface than Alpala did. Rio Amarillo, Porvenir, La Hueca, Timbara, and the Shurug project are all things that look way better. And also Cisne Loja look way better on surface than Alpala did. And we own 100% of them. When you can see a porphyry system outcropping, you know you're on a good thing. Rio Murillo has four different targets. The best of those has a litho cap on it, which is bigger than Alpala. We can see the copper porphyry mineralization underneath that and gold grades that go up to an ounce a tonne in the litho cap. At Timbara, we've recently reported some spectacular outcropping gold grades in silicified zones within an outcropping porphyry system, and we're looking forward to drilling that. At Porvenir, we have outcrops that are twice the length and the same grade, and in some places a much higher grade for sections of it than we had at than we had at Alpala. So it's very important that we continue to push these exploration projects, and we are currently mobilising exploration programs at Porvenir. At Selen, we have a 1.2 by 700 metre zone in which every outcrop returns grades above 0.5 gold and 0.6 copper. The average is significantly higher than that. It's a coherent ore body that outcrops that we're ready to drill, and we're working on getting the tenements for it. La Hueca Target 6, similarly extensive. It has outcropping porphyry systems that are very similar to the drills that we encounter the porphyry system at Alpala in. So these things are standing out. They're outcropping. We don't really have to use geophysics to define them. We just need to drill them, and we're getting ready to do that. We have the opportunity to deliver three more of these sometime in the next 6 months with the drill bit. We operate in harmony with the Ecuadorian workforce, the Ecuadorian community at all levels, and the Ecuadorian environment. We take a lot of time and effort to make sure that we endorse the efforts of local communities, local businesses. We patronise the local businesses, and we try wherever we can to employ Ecuadorians. And that's why we have 97% of our workforce Ecuadorian, and of our geological team, approximately 30% are female geologists. So we're working hard to get on with Ecuador, with its people individually, with its families, with its local communities, the provincial governments and the national governments. As a result of that, we've had a largely injury and incident-free workplace. We've had a number of initiatives which show that we are very dedicated and real about making sure we look after the environment, particularly in the area of rehabilitation and reforestation. We've now planted more than 400,000 trees on our project area and rehabilitation activities, and we're very dedicated to local businesses and water quality. You know, we've set up coffee plantations, chicken farms, local bakeries, supported development initiatives at the local schools and health centres, set up fish farms. We have recycling plants. We have Alpala medical facilities and messing facilities. We employ all of the local communities in our water and soil sampling initiatives, both to involve them and to show them that what we are doing is honest and real. So the important thing here is to note that we're building a company here which will benefit an entire nation and help transform the economy of an entire nation. The Ecuadorian GDP is about 100 billion US. We aim, with just Alpala, to improve that by around about 4%. And we think that each one of our successive discoveries, appraisals and developments can do the same thing. So SolGold is on track to becoming one of the most important companies from an economic point of view as a primary producer and also a supporter of all levels of industry and commerce right through the entire nation. And that is why we're getting the endorsement of Franco-Nevada at the Alpala project level, and why we're getting the support of the Ecuadorian government at both the Alpala level and indeed all of our projects through Ecuador. So thank you very much for listening to this presentation. It's a very big story. That's why it took a little longer than one might normally get for a single project company. We're a national company. We're building an industry in Ecuador, not just one mine. Thank you.